While this podcast may discuss medical issues and at times answer or discuss listeners' questions, this podcast is not offering any individual medical advice, nor meant to substitute for individualized professional medical treatment or advice. So please remember that all content is for informational purposes only. And please consult with your own healthcare provider for your own issues and diagnosis. If you think you may have a medical emergency, do the right thing and call your doctor or go to a local emergency room or call 911 immediately. Never delay seeking individualized help for a problem based on something discussed here. Take care of yourself. You're worth it. Everybody, welcome back. We're up to 47 viewers, and thank God I'm funding this myself. I'm having a great time. I'm learning that I'm in the wrong career. I think is what I've been at this a long time, and I think this is. But I'm having fun getting some incredible people on the podcast, and we're talking about issues that. Most comedians don't talk about. Had my colonoscopy. I know a lot of you have been DMing me, making sure I'm okay. Everything was good, thank goodness. Lo and behold, when they were in there, they found my career. So everything, and a slide whistle from high school, which I can't get into that. But Travis, how you doing, man? Everything okay? I know you're near the fires. As we could see, you're in Paris. Mm-hmm. And how is everything, man? You're the California fires have been just ravaging the state again. It's mm-hmm. It's frightening. And but the QAnon people say it's a hoax. So why evacuate? Boy, those douchebags, you know, they're starting to troll me. They're starting to troll me again. They're trying to convince me.
Those are actually Russian bots. But I'm all things considered, yes. Story.
Sorry, go ahead. Well, show us the Trump painting that your daughter gave you.
My Father's Day gift.
Your Father's Day gift.
Yeah,
love this, the ponytail.
Now this I was bummed because I painted one of these and you liked it, so I gave it to you, and then
and it's in the green room in Vegas.
Yeah.
Right.
So which my daughter
becoming an opium den, opium.
Opium.
I gotta get new teeth.
Opium.
Show it again. This is Trump. Not really a profile guy, but he's holding the Bible upside down, and he has a knapsack. That's the flag. And
well, that's actually a hood.
Oh, that's a hood. Yeah. I think you got to get your daughter in art school. I don't want to say anything, but that's oh boy.
Yeah.
Oh boy. I said, when I'm going to do this, I'm not going to get political, and I can't help myself.
Can't stay away from it.
I just, because you know, my platform, you know, this goes out to 19 people. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a good time to use my platform to let people know that I'm just a loudmouth person who's afraid of democracy. And you're a veteran. You served during Iraq. You were stationed in Canada, sure. I believe.
Yep. Were you not?
Yes. Bone spurs. And it's funny how many veterans we talk to that are pro-Trump, even after what we heard, his wonderful quotes about the soldiers. But you and I know better.
You and I and most of America knows better. Generals, really a lot of Republicans are now starting to be vocal. If you don't already follow the Lincoln Project, all Republicans. So, you know, there's a lot of focus on the people that are supporting him, but there I think are a lot more that aren't, that are being vocal now about this because they realize now more than ever we need a sane voice at a time when this country couldn't be more divided, when focus needs to be put on knowledge, truth, compassion, and unity. Now we need to pull someone in there. You had your 4 years, you got your judges in place, you got all this stuff that you wanted and executive mm-hmm. orders and all that. Mm-hmm. Now let's get back to some civility so that we can actually be a great country again, because right now we're just too divided to be.
Yeah. And if I may remind you of something, Travis, it's my fucking show. Okay. So just, you know, when you come in, you just let us know how the family is and you let the big Jew do his thing. Okay. It's enough already. If you want your own podcast, I'm sure you can easily get one. I saw I'm so thrilled to have these folks on my show today. I saw this incredible, powerful documentary called Crip Camp on Netflix. I highly recommend it. It resonates louder today than ever. And I would now like to welcome the directors of that, Ms. Nicole Newnham and Jim LeBrecht. And Jim is one of the stars of Crip Camp as well. Welcome. Thank you for doing this. Somebody must have forced you to do this. Real quickly, is everyone okay? Can I get you anything? Jim, can I bring you anything? Oh, yeah.
I got my coffee.
What is that, Jim? A bong? I saw the show, so I'm wondering what you got.
Damn you.
Nicole, you're good. How about an omelet or anything? No? Would you mind if I show the clip to a Crip Camp, even though I brought you in? They say do the clip first, but this is how I don't listen to people. I say I want to bring in the people, the creators of this amazing thing, and then let's show the clip, and then we'll come back. Is that okay? Here we go.
Wait, you want me to tell them what happened? Well, two people got cramps, and they're spreading.
We were all very hyper about it. And I have to go shower some people.
Executive producers, President Barack Obama and Michelle Obama.
I wanted to be part of the world, but I didn't see anyone like me in it.
I hear about a summer camp for the handicapped run by hippies. Somebody said you probably will smoke dope with the counselors, and I'm like, sign me up.
Disabled campers play guitar and sing.
Come to Camp Jeanette and find yourself.
There I was at Woodstock.
Campers dance and play baseball.
You wouldn't be picked to be on the team back home, but at Jeanette, you had to go up to bat.
Even when we were that young, we helped empower each other. It was allowing us to recognize that the status quo is not what it needed to be.
Sundance Film Fest winner.
The world always wants us dead. We live with that reality.
At the time, so many kids just like me were being sent to institutions. It was just a continual struggle.
Most disabled people, like myself, are unable to use public transportation.
We needed a civil rights law of our own.
A Netflix original documentary.
A rehabilitation program has been vetoed by the president because it was cost prohibitive.
We decided we were going to have a demonstration.
You get the call to action, to the barricade.
Disabled protesters.
A small army of the handicapped have occupied this building for the past 11 days.
So many people from Camp Jeanette found their way into the building.
The deaf use sign language.
The FBI cut off the phones. The deaf people went, we know what to do. That's how we communicated to the people outside the building. The Black Panther Party would bring a hot meal. We were like this.
We are the strongest political force in this country.
Addressing congressmen.
We will no longer allow the government to oppress disabled individuals. And I would appreciate it if you would stop shaking your head in agreement when I don't think you understand what we are talking about.
Sit-in participants parade triumphantly.
What we saw at that camp was that our lives could be better.
A child rides his father's wheelchair. Protesters crawl up Capitol steps.
If you don't demand what you believe in for yourself, you're not going to get it.
I said
Crip Camp, a disability revolution.
Would you like to see handicapped people depicted as people?
Excuse me?
In select theaters and on Netflix March 25th. Rated R.
So powerful. Watch it. And they're back with us, Nicole, Emmy award-winning producer, writer, and director, and Jim LeBrecht from Berkeley, right? The Repertory Theater, where you kind of invented your own sound and design over there. You're known for that?
Well, that's where I started my professional career, was at the Berkeley Rep, and I worked there for about 10 years.
Right.
In 78 to about 89.
Now, how did this come together, this incredible documentary? Nicole, tell us about that.
Well, Jim is a legendary sound designer in the documentary world. He's mixed and sound designed hundreds of documentaries, including, you know, Academy Award-winning documentaries. And he has been my sound designer and mixer on my three previous films. And so over the years, I also saw Jim becoming increasingly powerful as an activist and advocate for better representation of people with disabilities in the film world, and also for better access for filmmakers with disabilities. And so I was really intrigued by his passion around the topic, and I realized it was like a whole world that I didn't know about. And one day I got lucky enough that he took me out to lunch and said, you know, there's films I want to see about people with disabilities that I'm not seeing, and I think you might be a filmmaker who'd be interested in some ideas. And he pitched me a few ideas, which were all good, but none of them really landed. And then it was just this, like, just sort of aside at the end of the meeting where he said, but you know what I've really always wanted to see is a film about my summer camp. And although I was like, okay, this could be really bad, because I think summer camp is the kind of thing that everybody feels really compelled by their own experience, but not everybody's summer camp needs to be a feature documentary. Sure. I was intrigued as to why. And then he started telling me about this wild hippie utopia in the Catskills down the road from Woodstock. And I realized it just like messed with my head, because I didn't have any images of people with disabilities, first off, in community at all, but second of all, like sort of on the cutting edge of protest culture and the 1970s. And that just sort of the idea of connecting that camp to this movement that too many people don't know about was super intriguing to both of us, and we decided to join forces on it.
And then, Jim, how did you acquire this footage from Camp Jened? Where was this treasure trove of all this stuff that was shot back then when you were there?
Well, that was a real treasure hunt. Okay. I remember when Nicole and I first started talking, I said, there was this group of hippie videographers that came to camp one summer. And I remember that they had actually given me a camera. They had strapped the big tape deck to the handlebars of my wheelchair. They gave me the camera, and somebody pushed me around camp. And I did a tour. And I said, only thing I can really remember is that the word people was the name of this group. And then and Nicole started spending months trying to figure this out and find, you know, where these people were and what this group was.
Right. Now, how old were you when you went to Camp Jened, and how did that come about? Did you want to go? Was it your parents' idea? Where was your head at during that?
Well, the footage from that you see in the film is when I was 15.
Okay.
And in the summer of 69, the summer of Woodstock,
yes.
I had been going to this other kind of straight camp, you know, where you like had to like go to bed by 8 o'clock, and you know, you were in a dorm, not a bunk. That summer, a bunch of campers from Camp Jeanette were there because their dining room had burnt down during the winter. And so there was no camp that summer. And I started hearing these stories about this camp where you're in a bunk, not a dorm, and the counselors sleep in the same bunk with you, and there's music playing, and you might be able to smoke dope with the counselors.
Fabulous.
And so at the end of summer, my dad comes to pick me up, and you know, Dad, I heard about this other camp, and I don't know. I think I'd like to try that next year. And he's like, oh, okay, that's great. And you know, that's how I wound up at Camp Jeanette.
Now, it seems like it really wasn't supervised by, you know, there's always, you know, the people that are the trustees of a camp or people that kind of look in to see what was, it looks like everyone was able to do their own thing, and which was very powerful. Who really put this camp together and who ran it and let these things happen?
Well, I mean, there was a long kind of history going back to the 50s where the camp became a camp for people with disabilities. But when I was there, it was run by Larry Allison. But there was a number of people that kind of were kind of top level folks working there. And, the film may make it, and I may make it sound like there was mayhem and orgies every 3 days.
People got crabs, Jim. People got crabs. Okay, that doesn't happen at my theater camp in the Poconos.
Oh, that's
all right. All right. Well,
it does. I'm sure it does. Yeah.
I guess you have to sleep with people for that to happen. Yeah. I wasn't that lucky. I was playing caroms most of the time alone. But go ahead.
There were some remarkable things happening there. And as you see it in the film,
it's incredible.
You know, you see like encounter sessions, right? Where you remember that scene in the Red Call where people were talking about, Nancy Rosenblum and what they really thought about her. So there was a great deal of freedom, but that was part of what was so important, as opposed to us being infantilized, being very, very structured, and not being able to make decisions for us, not given the opportunities to make decisions for ourselves about what we're going to do. Here we were in a place where we got to grow up and we got to feel really good about our capabilities, and that, you didn't feel like you were being treated than less than, but here I am.
Are you feeling that way right now during my podcast, Jim? Because I can tell Nicole's looking for an Uber. Nicole, let me ask you, how do you put something like this together? I mean, you've done some incredible documentaries, and I know Jim has too. When this idea comes about, how did you tap into it? And it looks like the political movement part of it was something that became developed obviously after Janed. How did you put those two dynamics together?
Yeah, I mean, that was for me one of the core things that I was excited about, was this idea that, this experience of freedom had a ripple effect that was felt so powerfully years later. And that was Jim's idea. Jim said that from the very first conversation we had. He said, I think there's something about the experience we had there and the freedom we had that might be connected to this group of people who came out to Berkeley from the camp and started getting involved in the movement. And then I started reading about this crazy, amazing sit-in, which is the longest takeover of a federal building in US history, by over 100 disabled activists that kind of pushed forward and caused the first disability civil rights law to happen. And I thought, how amazing if we could, at that point we didn't have the footage. So we were thinking of casting young actors with disabilities and kind of recreating the feel of the camp and connecting it to the movement later. And we knew there was that incredible footage of Judy Heumann in the building, during this hearing saying these incredible things. But really, it was like such an amazing thing. It was like, if you build it, they will come kind of thing. Yeah. Like once we started thinking of that and looking for the footage, we realized this is like this completely ignored but really important chapter in US history. And there's obviously like a reason why people never really wanted folks to understand the story of how disability rights were fought for by disabled activists themselves, And so I felt like the footage just started emerging. First I found this little ad in the back of a magazine that said Crabs Outbreak Camp Janed for the Handicapped, $6.95. It was a little tape that the Video Coalition was selling. And that led me to the coalition, and the footage came about, and then we start finding all.
So what do? You Google crabs or what? how do you get to, why has crabs become such a huge thing in this? So as far as finding Judy, who was so prominent in the footage from the people, right? From the people, I'll call them the filmographers, they were called the people. So the later footage had nothing to do with that group of people that were shooting the stuff at the camp. They had nothing to do with it.
Right.
And you knew about Judy's activism and everything else, and you just pieced it together?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And we were looking for footage for literally years. And we had like a team of incredibly dedicated people helping us trying to track it down. And we were finding footage in like boxes that had literally never been looked at before within archives. They hadn't even been itemized. In some cases, it took like literally over a year just to get the archives to release the footage to us because they were stuffed in a basement somewhere and had never been looked at before.
And who owned that footage at the time in the archives?
Well, some of the archives were like, you know, university archives that activists had given the tapes to, you know, and then once we discovered it, we realized, oh, you know, it was from this particular news station in the Bay Area where their archive burned down in the 80s. And, you know, they actually owned it, but they didn't even have a copy of it anymore. You know, it was that kind of treasure hunt.
Unbelievable. Jim, are you in contact with any of the people that you went to Camp Jened with? Do you?
Sure. I mean, one of the first people Nicole and I called was Judy Himmon. And right. Judy and I have stayed friends, you know, a little bit spotty over some of the years, but stayed friends. And I've been in touch with her, you know, recently. We started working on this film over 5.5 years ago. So Judy really was kind of the connection to a lot of people. Denise and Neil Jacobson live in Oakland, which is where Nicole and I both live in Oakland also. So I would see them at certain, you know, events within the community.
Sure.
So there were some folks, but I hadn't talked to Lionel in a while. We had, you know, there had been a couple of reunions, but we wound up having one on the West Coast. So I had seen him a while ago.
Yeah. I could have used a camp like that. I went to one camp when I was growing up, and it was, I had a lot of fear growing up, you know, and anxiety. And, you know, I was like a 9'11" you know, that had no athletic prowess at all. So I just, you know, I spent a lot of time, you know, in the corner smelling objects. I'm not going to lie to you. And that's okay. I know you'd be the, but they sent me to, you know, my mom was like, you should really go to a sleepaway camp. And that way, you know, you wouldn't be afraid. Mom had a little grip on the grape. And so I said, well, there's no way I'm going to go to a sleepaway camp because, you know, I'm 9 feet tall, but I'm you know, I'm scared of sleeping anywhere next, you know, I couldn't imagine a bunk next to a stranger. I mean, to me, the way that was a hostage scenario, you know, the way I was raised. So I went to a day camp where, you know, they would put you on and you'd go home before it would get dark, you know, like a lunatic. But I watched, you know, when I watched Crip Camp, I went, oh my God, that's what I needed, where everybody was just part of something. You know what I mean? Because school, I never fit in. And then I went to the camp with the same students from my school and I never fit in. So, you know, my summer was a nightmare, but there was something just incredible about Camp Jened. Did parents know, Jim, I mean, exactly what was going on and the freedom that was being embraced there? What was that? Was that encouraged? Was that okay? Did the parents not know? When I say that, it's like, you know, getting high and stuff like that, which later in life, you know, I couldn't stop and I had to deal with that. But I mean, the freedom that, you know, the parents, how open were they to the environment of Jened? Did they know what was happening?
Well, Brad, we were like every other kid, you know, it's kind of like, you know, guilt by omission. Is that what they call it? It's like, you didn't go, you know, certainly, two counselors had wound up getting the crabs, and you know, and they had made love. The
fucking crabs again. This is
kind of the point.
So, if the counselors get crabs, they're stripping some of the campers.
No, please don't go.
This is another. Don't go another documentary on me. So why did everyone have crabs? Was it a thing in 69?
Not everybody had the crabs. We had to make sure that that it didn't spread. And so they had been off camp at an abandoned house. They got the crabs. And we had some campers that were going to be going home soon. And basically, Larry Allison said, look, everybody's got to quarantine and shampoo with Quell shampoo just so that we're sure that no one's going home with the crabs and it's not spreading through the camp. But it was really, you know, them being very, very careful about this because, you know, it's a summer camp. We're all sharing combs and towels. And
okay. Is that your excuse? Jim, you've never used a comb in your life. I mean, come on, let's be honest. You and I, we have the same hair. You let it go. I just came back from Chimpanzee Barber College because I'm afraid to go to Fantastic Sam's. But I only cut crabs once, if I could say. It was against my will. And it was something I didn't, it was actually from a, my mom was like, you probably got it at a buffet. She really thought it was a buffet that I ate it. Cause with her fifth husband, we would go to this buffet at the country club and then they would leave me.
Yeah.
Two, three days.
You know, but, in the footage, we hear Gene, someone Gene Malfrant say, you know, it's spreadable. And, you know, and that was during the time of, you know, when they were documenting the crabs outbreak. So when we went to Sundance, we had a bunch of t-shirts printed up, and on the back it kind of said Camp Jeanette, it's spreadable, you know. Or it's like, okay,
the best. That's, and it was huge at Sundance. You've been to Sundance a few times, Nicole, right? You've had four Sundance in the documentaries, and I'm sure it's because of streaming. It seems to be it's really, I hear people talk about documentaries that they're watching more than regular series, more than films, because I think obviously the new outlet, the streaming and everything is giving that, you know, the availability, the showcase, and it's some of the best stuff out there. Are you finding, both of you, that it's becoming a touch easier with this type of a medium? Or?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's a different world, definitely, than the one that we had been working in for 25 years. And what's so exciting about that for a film like Crip Camp is that it really gets a chance by being on a platform like Netflix to be a part of the cultural conversation, which is what we really wanted. We really wanted to make a film that was going to really change cultural perception around disability culture and people with disabilities, and not, you know, be something that would just explode those sort of sad tropes that we usually get in the media around disability, yes, which are the sort of like inspirational thing or the, you know, tragic thing. And so, like really being able to work with Higher Ground and have the Obamas as executive producers.
Did you get to meet them? Did you? You didn't, right? To meet the Obamas?
A phone call, which was amazing. Yeah.
A phone call with both of them?
With him.
With him.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
And
name come up? Did my name come up at all? Jim, be honest, because you're in sound design. I'm sure you recorded it.
You know, he talked about a lot of people, Brad, but not you.
Okay. All right. That's fine. There's an off button. So yeah, my gosh, to work. I mean, he's really one of my heroes. And but that he would talk about and be a producer. So honestly, would it have gotten off the ground without executive producers like that, do you think? Was this part of his Netflix deal? Because I know they have one, right?
Yeah, it was. It was the first film actually that they had their names on as executive producers through that deal. And which I think says a lot about them, you know, that this
sure
is the film they want to come out with. And you know, they did watch several cuts and give feedback, and I think
did they give feedback on that?
Right? Yeah.
Like, so they gave notes like were they great notes or were they network? Nobody watches this, so you can't get in trouble. Were they great notes or were they network notes? Were they things like I need a three shot of the wheelchair? It wasn't weird shit like that. Was it notes that were really helpful? And did you take Barack's notes, Nicole? Because I could tell you're a rebel. Did you just go, oh, that's so good, Mr. President? And then did you hang up and go, and Jim says, fuck it, it's my thing. I'm the one who got the crabs. I'm the one who paid for. Yeah, I mean, were they helpful notes?
They were. They were helpful notes. They were the kind of notes that were like questions or kind of things that kind of shifted the way we thought about certain things. And even if we didn't address the specific thing, they were helpful in terms of us thinking overall about what we were trying to accomplish and what particular scenes were saying. And, you know, Priya Swaminathan, who works for Higher Ground, who's incredible, said, you know, you're going to get these notes and just bear in mind, like, this is a perspective that only one person in the United States or really in the world has, you know? And that's true. It's like, you know, it's thinking that comes from such an informed and sensitive place. So yeah, it was great.
Jim, I'm getting the feeling you really didn't care Barack had notes. I'm getting the feeling you're like, look, you're not in the White House. I'll do what I want. What was it like for you to see something like this finally get the important notice that it needed? That had to be pretty powerful for you, yeah? Not just on a creative level, but in a humanistic level.
No, I mean, I've been kind of an activist for most of my life. And
so, where do you think the disability conversation is? Are you happy where it is right now as far as disability rights and moving forward and where you'd like to see it? Where's your head at?
I mean, I think there's a new generation that is very, very important. And it's called disability justice. And it really kind of looks at the issues that we're facing from the point of view of Black, Indigenous, people of color, LGBTQ, people that have been marginalized in society. I mean, they are really doing a lot of the hard work right now in basically the same issues that we've always faced, which is not having the adequate health care. And not, being thought about, when, PG&E decides that they need to shut off power because their power lines are setting off fires in the mountains. Well, they shut off power, but that's also shutting off power to people's breathing devices.
Yes.
And powering their wheelchairs and stuff. And so, there's a group here in the Bay Area that got together called the Disability Justice Culture Club, and they have been working towards providing basically mutual aid within the community. And so, the new generation are people that we really should be following and, listening to.
Yeah.
I'm excited about those people.
Yeah, I am too. And it feels different, but it feels also like we're fighting the same old white guys. It seems like we want to hand off to that, whatever that generation is, but it feels like the same struggle, whether it's Black Lives Matter or disability rights. It sounds like we're handing it off as opposed to really growing from it. I have a nonprofit that helps families with children that have life-limiting illnesses, and they're being so wiped out financially with or without, if you got insurance and you're taking care of a child that's terminal, the 20% deductible will wipe you out. And they're on life support and they can't pay their utility bill. And we're running down to, PG&E or DWP, and we're literally paying for their bill that's over, so it's like, it's the same scary scenarios that seem to be just going on. When is it gonna, hit that ceiling where the people that really run it, that make the calls, are gonna get it? How do we make that leap?
Well, I mean, we talk about healthcare, but it really isn't. I think you ask anybody with a disability, I'll tell you a horror story about being denied benefits, or I now am on an individual plan. I had my own company. We had a small plan. And as an individual person, I cannot purchase a plan that'll cover wheelchairs or CPAPs. I'm sitting in a $25,000-$30,000 wheelchair. It doesn't last forever. And right. I don't know why my BiPAP has lasted as long as it does. So we're not really looking, we're not really looking at what I think the goal should be, which is making sure that everybody can participate in society and that they should not be burdened by, it's not like, let's give everybody everything free, but there is a point in which everybody who's listening to your podcast can come across these same problems.
Absolutely.
And even as a young man, I thought, why are people having bake sales to pay for their kids' chemotherapy?
I see that. I see that all the time. And it's a travesty. And looking at the cultural climate right now, I'm not, and I don't even know if it's the influx of the social media that is getting me crazy You know, I watched the Social Dilemma the other night, that documentary, fascinating. It gets me crazy. You know, oh my God, I'm in this. I'm seeing what's happening. But with all this awareness, it seems to be getting more divisive. And I what's scaring me is, you know, I always thought a lot of that was politics, but a lot of it is society. Society is now, it almost feels like we're close to a civil war, which makes us feel further apart to getting help to people who need it. You know, the healthcare is the number one issue for me in the world, and almost everyone has it, and we don't, and it feels like we're moving away from it. And I just don't know what has to change. It feels like the same, this is none of my business, Jim, but excuse me. And you don't have to answer it. Does your insurance cover the crabs? And I'm beating this because I have to tell you, I'm worried about the hair. And what I'm going to do is I want to meet you, Jim, somewhere in a public, and I want to check you for ticks, because it is flea and tick season, and I care about you because, you know, you're in one of my favorite films. Nicole, you're lovely. I can, you know, I read body language. I was a psychic before, and I could tell you feel like you'll never get this hour back. But thank you for doing this. You know, not everyone's fucking Oprah, all right? So thank you for being here. Jim, you're an inspiration. Nicole, and thank you for this. Crip Camp on Netflix. Grateful to you both. Tell Barack to please come back. Be careful. Stay safe. Thank you. This meant a lot. I know Erin had a lot to do with this. And she was like, just do your homework so you don't look like an idiot. So tell her, you know, I did the best. I fall asleep a lot. I have a thing where I think of my childhood, and I gotta go to a different place. But I love you both. And I know it's not a Hollywood thing. I love what you're doing and the awareness that you're bringing all of us. Jimmy, call me if you need something. I have batteries, whatever the fuck you need. Call me. And any way I could be helpful or a loud voice in your cause. I love doing that because I have a lot of time and not much. So I don't know if you need people that are inappropriate, but I'm always here. And thank you for your voices.
Look, you're a great guy, and I'm so happy that we got a chance to hang out with you for a little while. And I just, you know, keep going, brother. Keep going.
Yeah, you too, my friend. You too.
And you about us. Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, for Nicole, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure. And I'm wishing you all the best, both of you. Take care. Stay well. That was a boy. They're smart people. I felt a little over my head. Travis, are you there? Are you done cleaning your rifle? Where are you? Hi, honey. Are you boy? They're incredible. An amazing documentary. Did you watch it? I know, course, it's tough, yeah, for you to get. I know you still watch Cinemax, but have you gotten a Netflix and watched it? It's pretty powerful, right?
What you were saying about documentaries and movies, my wife and I every Sunday morning sit down and have coffee and watch documentaries. We actually saw that documentary shortly after it hit Netflix, and we were just like, what are we even watching? It was this amazing story that, you know, like I was saying to you earlier, the Richie Havens Freedom song comes on. You feel like you're watching songs. Woodstock. It's like, oh, this is amazing. And now I'm learning all this, the adversity that they came up against with the disability acts and the politics that were behind it. I was just like, wow.
And it hasn't stopped. And there's still, you know, it's that still uphill battle. And what's amazing is when I watched the documentary, it felt so ahead of its time. That's what it was enthralling. I mean, I was just really sucked in. I went, wow, this is really great. This is where you know, it's a camp where they're being embraced and they're able to do their own thing. But it felt like, wow, this is a movement that is so needful right now. Mm-hmm. 1969. And you know, these people need insurance more than any, and it's still the same. It's still the same. Well, now I'm depressed. Now I'm depressed. I'll tell you, you know, I could see that, you know, every time I'd look at Nicole, she was like, you know, but I, you know, she's a very bright woman. And, you know, the woman I'm with, she's a little younger. She's on her activity blanket right now in a corner with her juice box.
You got to keep bringing smarter people than you on because it does make you look smart.
I'm insecure. That's why when I had on, you know, the guy who directs traffic at the school, I felt like I was really in my wheelhouse.
Yeah.
I am a little intimidated. You know, I'm not a great reader, but I you were in the Army, so you probably had crabs.
No, don't cuss at me like that. I'm
sorry, Marines. Okay. Marines. All right. That's okay. And I had the crabs only once in my life. And this is how, and I really didn't know. I didn't know how, you have no idea how naive I was. Seriously. You know, and when the mom said you probably caught it at a buffet, because my mom, God bless her, you know, four marriages, you know, you tell my mom to sit down, she'd lay down. Little loose and a great woman. Wanted love. So when mm-hmm. she said, you probably caught the crabs from a buffet, I actually played. And one of my friends, I grew up in the Valley, not a think tank in California, San Fernando Valley. And he said, you got to get some of the shampoo. He said to me, he talked like that. He was an 18-year-old gangster. Yeah. Well, gangster for my neighborhood, which means he tore the tag off his mattress. In my neighborhood, this was a felon. Okay. Yeah. So he said, you got to get some of the shampoo. You got to get some of the Prel. You got to get some of the Prel shampoo. So he says Prel, which is the green shampoo. Remember the commercial? They would drop a pearl into it or whatever. Yeah. You don't know.
The wrong shampoo, though.
That's right. And it's Prel. Yeah. It's Prel. So I get Prel and I lather up Area 51. And I finished about 3 days later. And it didn't help. It didn't help. Little did I, it's Quell or Krill? Krill. I think I had Krill. I had Krill because I was a larger person. Most people get crabs. I got Krill, which is what, don't shake your fucking head, Travis. Remember what you were doing before this. Horrible. Okay. Remember what you were doing. Okay. You were down at the UA trying to, you know, get the foot fixed. I've given you a life and I'm saying that with a lot of love. Mm-hmm. All right. Watch Crip Camp. Trav, thanks for doing this. And
my pleasure, man.
Help out people. And we got to work on my opener. It sounds so douchey. I sound like I'm talking someone off a bridge, but my attorney is like, you have no right to give advice about mental health, even though I have multiple personalities and I hear voices. So I think who else but me should talk about it. So my disclaimer, I don't know. I tried speeding it up, but then it sounded like I didn't care. And then when I slow it down, it sounds like a bad, episode of Dr. Welby. Look that up. That's how old I am. But take care of yourselves. Take care of people who need it. Ask for help. It's okay. I'll see you soon. They can't cancel me because I'm paid for this shit. Adios. While this podcast may discuss medical issues and at times answer or discuss listeners' questions, this podcast is not offering any individual medical advice, nor meant to substitute for individualized professional medical treatment or advice. So please remember that all content is for informational purposes only. And please consult with your own healthcare provider for your own issues and diagnosis. If you think you may have a medical emergency, do the right thing and call your doctor or go to a local emergency room or call 911 immediately. Never delay seeking individualized help for a problem based on something discussed here. Take care of yourself. You're worth it.